stress and mindfulness on health. I'm currently fasting, and mindfulness, I guess, takes my mind away from food and also water, right? So I'll do my best today to give a presentation to everyone. So today, I'd like to share with regards to what happens when we are stressed, how mindfulness affects our health, and stress and mindfulness in the profession of caring. So let me begin by sharing with you how the life of a geriatric consultant is 24 hours prior to this conference. So I usually sleep at about 12 midnight. It will take some time to drift to sleep, toss and turn, and then I'll be sound asleep. But at about 3 plus, I woke up to pass urine, and then I'll fall asleep again. Unfortunately, at 5 plus, my two cats will be meowing away, wanting to be fed. They are like my alarm clock. And at 6 plus, I'll start feeding them, bathe, and get up ready to work. Traffic is a nightmare in the morning because it's peak hour. And then when I reach office at about 8 a.m., I'll start putting my emails and eventually start my walk rounds at about 8:30. So walk rounds can be quite stressful, and we try to teach the junior doctors. At the same time, we try to render good care to our patients, especially the elderly. So at about 12, if it's not fasting month, usually I have a quick lunch, I clear my emails. Yesterday what I did was, I had a session with a junior doctor and do a bit of teaching. My clinic starts at about 1:30 on Friday afternoon. It's a memory clinic. So it's a busy clinic. I'll try to rush and clear all the clinic cases. And by about 4 plus, I'll end the clinic and I have to go to the ward for exit rounds. It's only at 5 plus, I get to sit at the office and take a breather and stone in front of my laptop. Sounds familiar to all clinicians, I guess. At 6 plus, it's time to go home. Again, against the peak hour. I'll drive home, simple dinner. Can only manage to wave to my cats. I have no time for them. And then I'll just watch Korean dramas to relax. Stone in front of the television. And then go through the slides for this conference today. And to relax, I read news feed on Facebook. And then at 11 plus, I get palpitations, one day before the conference. Yes, I still do get palpitations when giving talks to a large audience, all right? So as you can see, this is what stress is all about, even myself as a clinician. So to put it in a graphical form, let me just show you this graph over here. So when there's a bit of stress, our performance will improve. We still remain calm. And when stress increases, our performance can still increase up to an optimal point. And this is a period when you have new stress, which is what we call beneficial stress. But as your level of stress continues to increase, your performance will drop. You get fatigued, you get exhausted, your health suffers, you suffer burnt out and breakdown. We call it de-stress. So to qualify, I was in the new stress period of preparing for this conference, not in distress. So this figure shows the stress response system, where signals from the brain get transmitted to the adrenal glands, which is just above the kidneys, releases the hormones, stress hormones like adrenaline and cortisol. And what these chemicals do is that they affect changes in different organs in the body, like the lungs, the heart, the liver and the stomach. So there's this small structure in the brain called the hypothalamus, which is the command center. So what hypothalamus does is that communicates with the rest of the body through the system which we call the autonomic nervous system. And there are two types of autonomic nervous system. We have the sympathetic nervous system, which is similar to an accelerator or gas pedal of a car, and the parasympathetic nervous system, which is the same as like the brake. So what does the sympathetic nervous system do? So it widens our eyes so that we can see better and start running when there's imminent danger, stimulates glucose release by liver so that we have energy to actually run, and it relaxes the bladder so that you even don't feel like you want to go to the toilet. Can you imagine giving a talk like this and you feel like going to the toilet? Right? So this is called the fight, fright, or flight response. So what about the parasympathetic system? It decreases your heart rate, it makes you relax, contracts your bladder, stimulates digestion. And we call it the rest, digest, restore response. So what happens when you are feeling stressed out? So if you have a mild stressor, your sympathetic stress reaction increases. Basically, your fight and flight response is there, while there's lessening of your rest and restore state. After the stress has passed, your body will return back to normal, and as you can see here, the parasympathetic response, which is the blue color line, actually is higher than the stress, the flight or fight response. For example, some of the stress I can be feeling is when you have to submit a deadline, submit a work according to a certain deadline that's been set by the boss. So what about chronic stress? So when there's a moderate stressor, your flight or fight response actually increases and it's more intense. And what happens is that if you have persistent stress, it never goes back to normal. You are always at that state of chronic stress. For traumatic stress response, for example, for someone who perhaps has gone through a road traffic accident and keeps replaying the same stress, the same images of the accident over and over again. So what happens is that you have this co-activation of both systems, both the flight and fight response together with the rest and restore response. So they can actually alternate between a depressive shutdown and even extreme anxiety or rage. So stress can affect our body functions in many ways, and there are various systems that it is involved. You have the cardiovascular, respiratory, neurological, gastrointestinal, endocrine, and also the immune system. So for cardiovascular, chronic stress can actually cause accumulation of fatty deposits on the walls of the arteries and causes heart attacks and high blood pressure. Chronic stress itself can even trigger abnormal heart rhythms like atrial fibrillation, palpitations like what happened to me, but it was acute stress that I'm feeling, not chronic stress. And it can also cause premature heart muscle contractions. So how do stress contribute to cardiovascular disease? So when there's a release of these stress hormones like cortisol and adrenaline into the bloodstream, what they do is that they actually cause a release of unhealthy, they cause the levels of unhealthy cholesterol like low density lipoprotein to rise. At the same time, you get a sympathetic system that is being aroused, your blood pressure increases, your platelet gets stickier. So when your platelet gets stickier, what happens? Your blood clots more, right? And high blood pressure damages your heart, blood vessels, and other organs in your body, for example, the kidneys. For respiratory system, air passes through the bronchioles, which are air tubings, to the air sacs called alveoli, where oxygen from incoming air passes into the bloodstream. So there's an exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is then gets drawn back to the air tubings and expelled out. So we have autonomic nervous system that constricts and dilates the air tubings. So what happens when you're so stressed out? For example, there's a perceived threat of setting news or emotional confrontation. The air tubings will constrict and find it very difficult to breathe. There's difficulty in terms of air movement. So it can actually trigger wheezing, breathlessness. And this is quite what we see for those who has asthma and they have asthma attacks. So stress can induce asthma attacks, induce asthmatics. So what about the brain? As what Dr. Lazan had mentioned earlier, just need to remember the prefrontal cortex and the amygdala and the hippocampus. So prefrontal cortex makes choices, allow us to pay attention, like what everyone is doing right now, paying attention to the talk. So I can see your prefrontal cortex activating. Alright? So amygdala reacts automatically in response to perceived threats. So if you see anyone who's angry, you must tell that person your amygdala is reacting right now. And it can get in the way of making wise choices. So what about hippocampus? Is what we call the memory center. It regulates learning and memory, and it contains receptors for the stress hormones. So there are three phases of memory. You have encoding phase, you have the storage phase, and you have the retrieval phase. So I'll give you an example. If you are teaching your child mathematics equations or formulas, if you are giving him a lot of stress, can you please remember this formula? Why can't you even remember a simple formula? The child will not be able to learn because it cannot encode. So you cannot expect the child to remember anything. If you cannot encode, you cannot store, you cannot retrieve. Alright? So let's say your child has already learned the mathematical equation. You need him to store the information and the knowledge learned. So how you store that is through multiple exercises. But if you actually stress the child so much, it's impossible for him to consolidate all this information. And what the brain is trying to do is to put it into the hippocampus as long-term memory. But with so much stress, you cannot put it into hippocampus. Alright? And finally, if let's say everything has been consolidated, everything has been learned, the next day, you ask your child, so what's the mathematical equation I ask you to remember or memorize? You keep on stressing your child without giving him the opportunity to actually tell you. So what happens that he cannot recall? It's impossible. So moderate stress actually impairs retrieval from long-term memory. So this is something that we need to be mindful of when we even want to teach our kids or even teach our colleagues or even teach anyone. So the relationship between stress and mental health basically is when we have a sustained or chronic stress. It causes elevated stress hormone levels like cortisol and reduced serotonin and dopamine levels, which are the chemicals in the brain. This has been linked to depression. And prolonged stress also can cause changes in the brain structure and reduce the function of the hippocampus or the memory center and the prefrontal cortex, so increasing the risk of depression and anxiety. And increased stress also lessens the lack of sleep, causes insomnia, and alters the circadian pattern. What about the gastrointestinal system? It increases stomach acid secretion, and this leads to heartburn, inflammation of esophagus, which is the feeding tube, and development of gastric ulcers. So you find when you're very stressed, you actually can get a bit of gastric discomfort. And it can cause abnormal contractions in the small intestine and colon, and this affects gut motility and you feel constipated. It also affects the permeability of the intestines and even the inner lining of the intestine or the gas or the stomach. And this inner lining actually helps to defend the body against bacteria. So for the endocrine system, acute stress decreases these hormones, the thyroid hormones, growth hormones, and the reproductive hormones. It increases our blood pressure, production of glucose, breakdown of glycogen, which is the storage form of glucose, breakdown of fats, increase the level of cortisol. Chronic stress can lead you to develop metabolic syndrome. For example, diabetes, sarcopenia, which is the loss of muscle mass. It happens in the elderly quite often. And visceral obesity, where you have storage of fats around the abdomen, within the abdominal cavity, especially around the pancreas and the liver. And chronic stress also can cause decrease in bone density and strength, thus leading to osteoporosis. We have two types of immune system. We have the fast response, which is innate immunity, and the adaptive immunity, which is a slow response. So our skin and the inner lining of the gut and also the respiratory system actually prevents invaders. So chronic stress state causes the release of chemicals that influence the immune responses because they bind to the receptors on the white blood cells. And these chemicals affect the function and the distribution of the white cells or the immune cells. So we get a weak immune system. It's because of the suppression of these cells to fight infection and the chronic inflammatory state that harms the organs. So we know stress can affect our health. So what about mindfulness? How does mindfulness affect our health? Just to reinforce, so now is the encoding part, right? Consolidation part. Mindfulness is about paying attention in a particular way on purpose, in the present moment, non-judgmentally. So there are various relaxation techniques that incorporate mindfulness principles that can affect physical health, cognitive health, and emotional health. For example, when we did breath, when we did breath focus earlier on, it helps to lower blood pressure, improve our posture because we sit up straight, improves clarity of the mind, allow us to have a sustained level of attention, increase calmness and improve our mood. What about body scan? It heightens your awareness of pain, increase the awareness of the mind-body connection, and it builds discipline and patience. Mindfulness meditation enhances our immune system, lowers the heart rate, improves memory retention, and quality of sleep, on top of reducing depression and anxiety. Yoga, Tai Chi, and Qigong reduces the muscle tension, improves balance, especially in elderly, improves sleep and concentration, and also reduces depression and anxiety. For guided imagery, where we use mental images to invoke a certain kind of good feelings, we get less bothered by pain, enhances pain tolerance, disrupt patterns of rumination, and we get less nervous or upset. So basically, mindfulness wants us to be calm on demand and refocus our mind. And this leads to improvements in concentration and emotional well-being. So it activates the relaxation response, which helps to reduce stress. So in the pictorial form, we have our fears, we have tough to handle colleagues at work, we have ruminations of the past, and we have relationship stress. So what mindfulness is trying to tell us is pour your stress into a stress bucket and then throw it away. Does it make sense? And it just wants us to be well and happy. Perhaps you can repeat after me. May we be well and happy. Very good. So everybody's prefrontal cortex is really working very well. Pay attention. So I want to share with everyone about stress and mindfulness in the profession of caring. I care a lot for the elderly, and especially those with dementia. And my passion is in advanced dementia patients. So oftentimes we feel very frustrated because we could not do anything else to help these group of patients. But as we dig deeper into the literature, we realize that even in advanced dementia patients, there's a lot more things that can be done so that we become better clinicians. It is always a race against time at work. For those clinicians, perhaps you can identify with me, we are always rushing to finish our work runs early, rushing to clinics to see patients, rushing for meetings, and rushing to teach medical students or junior doctors. There's always constant decision making at work, be it in terms of treatment decisions, whether should I treat this patient or not, should I give antibiotics or not, should I do an x-ray, should I do more blood tests, should I do a CT scan. At the same time, we are thinking about discharge planning. Where is this patient going to go to? Is she going to go home, or is she going to go to a community hospital or even a nursing home? So these are the things that constantly goes through our mind as we do our work rounds. And work just keeps piling up. There's teaching activities, administrative paperwork and meetings, research work and writing papers. I really get a bit of anxious seeing the blocks piling up. I don't know whether the audience feels the same way as I do. But then I think that after going through the mindfulness course for the last 1 year, thanks to Angie, I realized that I need to make changes in mindset and how I interact with my colleagues and patients. That is the need to be mindful at work. So I need to make small changes within myself first. And then creating awareness and mindfulness among my colleagues and teaching them ways of being mindful at work, starting from fellow colleagues in the clinics. So we have started 2 sessions already in the GRM clinic, whereby we share with our fellow colleagues what are the ways of being mindful. And only then can we make big changes within the healthcare system. So what mindfulness taught me is that there are many issues in a complex healthcare system to tackle. Sometimes it's impossible, so what I need to do is just to accept the issues that cannot be solved easily and navigate around the issues and change my perspective. So how I apply mindfulness as a doctor is that when I feel angry, upset, or about to react negatively before my amygdala take over, I just need to stop and breathe 3 times. It does help a lot. And finally, before I speak, I ask myself 3 questions. Is it true? Is it necessary? And is it kind? If not, I shouldn't be saying this to my junior doctors reward rounds. And when there's less stress, more relaxation, there's wealth in health. And only then, a healthy carer can then care more heartily for others. So this is my last slide. So I guess before the conference, this is your baseline knowledge on mindfulness and stress, right? I'm very sure the first 10 minutes of my talk, everybody is absorbing the information. But I am very sure at this point in time, is you're letting it go already. But with a lot of encoding, consolidation during the conference, at the end of the day, it's higher than the baseline. Thank you very much.